So let's start the session. I am Ikra Aslam, lecturer of biochemistry at University of Management and Technology, Sialkot campus. In this effective guest speaker, Dr. Muhammad Ali, assistant professor, Akhubat Easy and Accessible CRISPR-Cas9 technology, which is making health. Oh, I'm sorry for the inconvenience, please. Bear with me. Sorry for the inconvenience, please. And informing me about my internet connection. Actually, इस वक्त यूनिवर्सिटी में बहुत ज़्यादा स्ट्रीमिंग हो रही है, तो शायद उसे ये इशू थोड़ा सा फेस करना पड़ रहा है. Sorry for the so without further ado, I should say over to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Because I'm facing a trouble in internet.
Yes, it's okay. So, assalamu alaikum once again. My name is Dr. Muhammad Ali. So I'm thankful to Dr. Ikra for a generous introduction. So today I will be talking about the generation of mouse models. Okay. So I will be talking about the generation of mouse models using engineered nucleases and the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. So we are using the mouse model for the biomedical research. Okay, let me add the waiting room. Let me talk. So we are using the mouse model for the biomedical research. We generate the mouse models for the human diseases because there are several reasons. There are several good reasons. One reason is that both the human and the mice have almost the same similar genome size. They have almost 3.1 billion base pair in the mouse, and humans have 2.9, almost 3 billion base pair. And most importantly, there is one-to-one gene correspondence between human and the mice. It is reported that almost 90% of the human genes are present in the animals. There is a high degree of genetic and physiological similarity between the humans and the mice. And also there are identical organs, tissues, and the cell between the humans and the mice. So that's why we are using the mouse models for the study of human diseases. Another good reason is that they are both time efficient and the cost efficient. They have a high breeding rate. The newborns are there after 21 days, gestation period 21 days for the mouse is there. And they have only the menstrual cycle of 6 days. They are also the cost efficient because they are kept in a small room and several experiments can be run in small space. That's why they are both the time efficient and the cost efficient. We will be using different terminology during this presentation. For example, the genetically modified organism we will be utilizing, the GEM will be its abbreviation. So there are several techniques for the generation of mouse models for the human diseases. We will be talking about in detail today about the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. So there are different strategies that are utilized for the generation of mouse models for human diseases. One of the strategies, for example, is natural selection. We are doing the inbreeding of the mice lines, and we are doing the sibling crossing or back crossing, and each of the line is differing from each other with respect to their genetic background. And each genetic background has specific phenotype and has specific uses. For example, the black B6 mice are utilized in the diabetes research, and white mice cannot be utilized in the diabetes research. But the white mice can be utilized in the liver injury studies, and they can also be utilized in the generation of monoclonal antibodies and some developmental work. White mice can be utilized because they are having high breeding rate. And the strategy that can be utilized for the mouse model for their use in the biomedical research is the reverse genetics. In the reverse genetics, what we do, we are introducing some mutation in the knockout cassette. This knockout cassette then is introduced into the embryonic stem cells so that there is a mutation of the same type in the embryonic stem cells. And these embryonic stem cells are then put inside the embryos, the one cell stage, and these Embryonic stem cells are grown for overnight inside this embryo, and these embryos are then put inside the surrogate mother, the pseudo-pregnant mother. And this pseudo-pregnant mother gives birth to the new bonds and the same mutation that was initially introduced into the knockout cassette is introduced finally into the new bond, and these new bonds are deficient of those genes that we want. And these mice can be utilized for specific experiments. For example, if we knock out the P53 gene, this mouse newborn will be deficient of resistance against the cancer development, because cancer is protected by the P53 gene. In this way, we can develop a model for the cancer by the knockout of P53 gene. In the forward genetics, we are utilizing some mutagen, and these mutagen are causing some DNA mutation, and correspond to those mutations, what is happening, the phenotype is appearing, and we can link that specific genotype with that phenotype, and this way we generate the mouse model of different diseases. There is another strategy of transgenics. For example, we are going to perform some experiment. We not only need the loss of function, sometimes we also need the gain of function for that protein, so that that phenotype is more pronounced. For that purpose, we introduce the transgene for which we want overexpression. That transgene is introduced into the zygote of the mouse, and this then fertilized eggs are put inside the mice uterus by the surgery, and these mice are then newborn are there that are having the transgene of our interest, and these transgene definitely express the proteins, and those are overexpression system in the animals. In this way, we can do not only the loss of function for a gene, but also the gain of function for that gene in the animals, and this way these animals are biological such. There is another strategy that is less frequently used, is the strategy of transposons. Transposons of known sequence are introduced into the genome. This transposon definitely can jump from one place to another place in the genome, and this way in the genome they sometimes cause the overexpression of the gene in their vicinity, and sometimes they are causing the down regulation of those genes. Because we know the sequence of those genes, this way we can recognize where those transposons have jumped to. So these are the five strategies I talked that are in general use. So there are two possibilities for the generation of mouse models in the biomedical research. That first of all, we have to select the gene of interest. This is actually the specialty of our lab when I was doing my PhD, and we are trying to do this same thing in the Pakistan. For the gene of interest, we are sometimes interested in the loss of function, and sometimes we are interested in the gain of function. If the loss of function and gain of function of a particular gene has the opposite phenotype, then we are sure that this gene has the same phenotype. So while talking about the loss of function, we can talk about the knockout mice. Knockout means we can cut that gene, specific gene, and that gene loses its function and no protein is formed, or the mutant protein is formed that is not functional. In this way, we can perform the knockout. So I'm continuously accepting the new participant, that's why some delays. Okay, so sometime we also need the RNAi based interference. The RNA is deleted by the RNAi technology, and this way the function of that protein, function of that gene is gone. And sometimes we overexpress the dominant negative, and the function of the real gene is gone because of the expression of those dominant negative. But the knockout is always not performed that much simply. Sometimes we need the spatial control of those knockout, and sometimes we need the temporal control of those knockout. Spatial mean if we want to study the function of P53 gene in the, for example, breast, we need to knock out P53 gene in only breast. And sometimes we need the function of that gene in the liver. We will knock out the P53 gene in a liver specific manner. In this way, the organ specific, tissue specific knockout is possible under this strategy. In the same way, sometimes we need the temporal control, means the time dependent control. Sometimes we need the knockout of P53 gene when the animal, the mouse, is adult, because many genes are that much important. If we knock out them from their birth point, they will not survive anymore. So we cannot study the function of those genes. That's why we need the temporal control of those genes. If we don't need this kind of strategies, temporal or spatial control, we make the conventional knockout. But if we need the temporal and spatial control, we are going to make the conditional knockout mice. So how we do? These conditional knockout mice can be generated by the use of LOXP site. We will be talking later. Conditional knockout, and sometimes we generate them through the overexpression of the Cre recombinase. And inducible system is also possible for the spatial and temporal control. But this is very useful. This is specialty of our lab, the generation of conditional knockout mice. So we are moving next. The gain of function is also possible for the generation of a mouse model for the biomedical research. Sometimes we do simple transgenic mice. The gene of our interest goes anywhere in the genome. This is called the simple transgenic mice, the conventional transgenic mouse. And sometimes we need the knocking, the insertion of gene of our interest at a specific locus so that some of the important gene, because of the insertion of our transgene, is not gone. So we do the knocking at our desired place. And sometimes virus mediated delivery is going to produce overexpression. For example, if we perform the viral mediated injection in the tail vein, the overexpression in the liver is there. So in the liver, it's easy to do the virus mediated overexpression. If we need the spatial control, it's important. And if we don't need the spatial control, then we can do in another way. If we don't need the spatial or temporal control, we simply perform the conventional knock-in mice. That we have performed many times in our lab, the conventional knock-in mice insertion at some specific loci in the genome. This is the conventional knock-in. And if we need the conditional, we perform the insertion of LOXP, stop LOXP in front of the gene of our interest. When we need the expression, we express some specific protein that removes the stop, and our gene that is downstream of these three elements become expressible. This way we are performing different strategies. Okay, we are moving forward. We are going from generalized to specific topic in our today's presentation. The Nobel Prize in the 2007 was given collectively to the Mario R. Capecchi, Martin J. Evans, and Olivia Smithies because of their discovery for the production of knockout mice using the embryonic stem cells. These are embryonic stem cells. What the strategy did they adopt? They utilize the embryonic stem cells from 129 SV strain of the mice. Those strain of the mice are containing a wild type gene, for example, gene X. This is the exon that has been shown in the box. This is the gene, and this is the exon, this is another exon. And the lighter lines are showing the intronic region. For example, they were interested to knock out this first. They want to delete the first exon because most of the time, the first exon is very important. The first exon is gone, protein function is gone, and we ultimately get the knockout mice. So they generated a knockout caser that is containing the new R gene. This is the selectable marker, and the left hand homologous arm and the right hand homologous arm that are compatible and has exactly the same sequence as the upstream of exon and the downstream of exons respectively. When they overexpress this knockout caset, this exon is gone and the knockout caset has made its place instead of this loci has the exon 1. This knockout embryonic stem cells have been shown somewhat with the white border, and these are without white border, these to distinguish in the picture. Then these knockout embryonic stem cells are then introduced into the embryos, and these embryos were then transferred to the pseudo-pregnant female. These embryos were taken at the 3.5 days after the mating of the mice. mice were mated, and at the 3.5 days we rupture open their belly, female belly, and we opened and we got the embryos and we introduced the embryonic stem cell. Then these embryonic stem cells on the next day after the overnight culture in the plate, we transferred to the pseudo pregnant female. Okay, and then these pseudo pregnant female gave birth to the mice, and someone were having the brown fur and someone brown fur with black patches. We can see these black patches, some of these genotyping can be performed to know which one is knockout and which one is the transgenic. Okay, at the next day they were mated with the B6 mice. These are called sometimes in abbreviation B6 mice, to get the next generation. And this next generation is performed with the genotyping, and we get the knockout mice. And this whole process is going to take 1 to 1.5 years. But then a new era came. Then an article was published, a mouse for all reasons. This paper was also talking about a mouse for every gene. They generated the knockout mouse for every gene, and they were providing to the whole world to facilitate the scientists for their biomedical research. Together with this one, they made a consortium. 22 institutes of the world made a consortium jointly named as International Mouse Phenotype Consortium. They knocked out each gene in separate mice, and they were providing to the whole world for their research work. And they also made an international knockout mouse consortium. They were providing the stem cells for the generation of knockout mice. So this is called this is one of the resources that was provided by the International Knockout Mouse Consortium. They were providing the embryonic stem cells that were having this kind of knockout allele. This is the exon 1, for example. This is the exon 2, and this is the exon 3. The greens are the exons, and we can see this red are the LOXP site. LOXP site are the characteristic when the Cre recombinase is expressed, then all the region between the LOXP site is deleted. This is the function of LOXP site. What is LOXP site? It is the sequence of DNA, small sequence, almost 32 base pairs. Is there 32 base pair, for example, is there, 32 is there, but the Cre recombinase will be expressed. What will happen? The region between the LOXP site is deleted, and we get the allele that is devoid of the exon 2. And this way, exon 2 is gone, and if this protein formed by this this mutant allele, mutant gene, will not be functional anymore. There is another strategy. Sometimes we express the flippase enzyme. Flippase enzyme, when is expressed, it will delete the region between the two FRT sites. And we are going to get this kind of allele first time. If we express again the Cre recombinase, we get this kind of expression. The eukaryotic cell, like human and mice, they don't have even the flippase or the Cre enzymes. So we have to express these enzymes from outside. But in our cells, we do have the recombinase enzyme. Any of the plasmids that have the homologous arms is there in the cells. The recombinase enzyme can take DNA sequence. So what happened? This whole region, because the International Knockout Mouse Consortium was providing the knockout embryonic stem cells, so this whole portion is gone. This portion has been taken by the International Knockout Mouse Consortium. So what is the next? Then the stem cells are directly introduced into the mouse embryos, and then the knockouts are produced this way, and this period has been reduced to 0.5 to 1 year, 6 months it almost takes because of this consortium. What is the next? Next is the era of engineered nucleases, what we will be talking about in detail, but we will be teaching to the students how to design the CRISPR-Cas9. I have devised a very simple strategy, and I will be showing you how to design the CRISPR in your lab, and every one of you can do this thing. It's very simple. So engineered nuclease can cut the genome from anywhere. It can cut the genome in vitro, it can cut the genome in the cell line, and it can cut the genome even in the mouse embryos that can be utilized to generate the knockout mice. It can even generate efficiently the knock-in mice, and it can even increase the efficiency of homologous recombination, because homologous recombination increases its efficiency when there is a double strand break. We will be seeing all these things. So there are three endonucleases that have been reported, and we will be comparing each one and why we selected CRISPR-Cas9 as compared to the rest of the endonuclease. We will be talking about this thing. One is the zinc finger nuclease. The zinc finger nuclease is containing two pair of proteins that are cutting the bottom strand, and the second member of the pair is cutting the upper strand, and this talent strategy is working almost a similar way, but the different proteins are required to recognize the sequence on the genome, and they do have the FOC1 enzyme that is a nuclease enzyme that can cut a single strand, and this single strand and single strand, both strands are cutting this with by the talent. And the CRISPR that has been shown, very simple, we will see its structure in detail in the coming slide, has the 20 mers usually of the complementary side, and it's the guided RNA, the scaffold RNA, that together with the Cas9 protein can cut the double strand with high efficiency, that is 3 base pair away from the PAM sequence. We will be seeing in the next slide in detail. So what is happening to the zinc finger nuclease? They are having the for the generation of mouse models and for the knockout in the cell line even, they have the efficiency of 20 to 78% with very low precision. And this was published in 2010. They are highly toxic. Homologous recombination can be performed, knockout can be performed, and knock-in can be performed. In the same way, talent technology is the next technology. It has efficiency almost 76% of the efficiency, the talent technology. And easy to design. These are difficult to design, not good, easy to design, but relatively low toxicity. So it is intermediate, it's a low toxicity. Next one is the ARGEN technology, RNA guided endonucleases, that are called the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. RNA guided endonucleases is the CRISPR-Cas9 technology. It's using the Cas9 protein. For example, we utilize in our lab the sgRNA, the guided RNA, single guided RNA, that is having the efficiency for the knockout is 90%, almost 90%, and easy to design, low toxicity, and recombinant Cas protein is utilized in here. And this was published by our lab, Sang et al, 2013, and this was again published by our lab in 2014, and we can see they are CRISPR are the best one. These CRISPR are the best one for the generation of knockouts. Okay, so what is CRISPR-Cas9 technology? This blue one is the Cas9 protein. This blue one is the Cas9 protein, and this is the double strand of the DNA. This is the upper strand, for example. This is the bottom strand. This is, for example, 5', and this is, for example, 3' of the upper strand. In the same way, the bottom strand 5 to 3' is running in the from the right to left. And these are two of the domains of the Cas9, RUBC domain, HNH domain. These are the nucleus domain that cuts the upper strand from here and that cuts the bottom strand from here. And this is the PAM sequence shown in red. Upstream of the PAM sequence, 20 mers are selected. What is PAM sequence? We will see. Upstream of the PAM sequence, 20 mers are selected, and these 20 mers are joined with this CRISPR RNA and also joined naturally under the natural condition. The tracer RNA is utilized, and in this way, this together, the complementary sequence together with this part of RNA invites the Cas9 with high specificity to come here to join this double DNA strand and make a double strand cut. So we will see. Two nuclease motifs are there on the Cas9 protein, we have seen, and this has been taken from the adaptive immune system from the bacteria, and we can see NGG, the PAM sequence is here, and the upstream of PAM sequence, 20 mers are joined with this tracer and the CRISPR RNA, and this is the double strand break has been shown here. So up till 2013, the different species, in the different species, different genes were knocked out with success. So we have actually what happened, this natural system having two guided RNA has been replaced with one guided RNA that has been shown with this loop. This single guided RNA is sometimes called the chimeric because it has been taken after being inspired from the natural system. Chimeric RNA together with Cas protein is efficient in knocking out the gene. So very interestingly, this is useful session for the new students, even first year BS students. I have designed one experiment for you to teach you how to design the CRISPR-Cas9 technology for the knockout of a gene to and to make the double strand break. This is the CAG, CAG promoter. This is CMV promoter along with enhancer. You can see this one as a promoter. This one is promoter. And this is the promoter of Cas9 protein. Cas9 coding sequence is downstream of the promoter. This is the MP3 in the selection marker. And this is U6 promoter that is efficient for the transcription of this guided RNA. This guided RNA has been taken from the exon 1. This has been taken from the exon 1. We will see how to take. This is the actual summary of today's experiment that I'm going to teach you. This is the wild type locus of the dirt. T is capital and rest of the letters are small. It means this is not the mouse gene. This is not the human gene. For the human gene, all letters are capitalized, right? And for the gene, it's always written in italic. And for the protein, it is written in regular. All genes, human gene, mouse gene, rat gene, genes are always written in italic. Okay, this is the exon 1, this is exon 2, and different exons go on, so on, and up till the 16 exons are there. And this CRISPR-Cas9 against the dirt, when it's overexpressed inside the cancer cell lines or inside the embryos, guided RNA binds to the exon 1 because we designed this for exon 1. And because after the guide RNA is bound, Cas9 protein is invited and it binds and cuts to the exon 1 and makes a double strand break. And during the repair of the double strand, cell make mistake, and sometimes there are insertion and sometimes there are deletion and sometimes there are insertion and deletion together. And there is many time a frame shift that make whole of the protein inefficient and the protein is not functional. This way, this gene is knocked out only because of the frame shift at the exon 1 and rest of the all of the exon are not going to produce the wild type protein. Okay, how to design? First of all, I will teach each step here. First of all, write ensemble mouse dirt in the Google. After you write these three keywords in the Google, we are going to design the knockout plasmid for the dirt actually. After you write this one, the first search is the gene dirt ENSMUSG and this number. Please click the first one. Please click the first one. After you click the first one, a new window will appear. This new window will appear like this one. This is the ensemble website and this dirt mouse gene resource has been opened. This is containing several resources for the mouse dirt gene. Please click on the sequence. I'm going to design the CRISPR-Cas9 plasmid for the knockout of dirt gene here. So this is the third step. Please click the sequence. After you click the sequence, a new window will appear. New window will look like this way. This new window will contain the... Okay, please all the participants turn off their videos so that there is no disturbance in the signal. All participants can turn off their video cameras. Okay. So this is the intronic region and this is the exonic region. All exons are shown in red and all introns are shown in dull black color, you can see. Please copy the sequence from GTT to CAG. Please copy the sequence of first full exon. After you copy the exon sequence from here, go to next page. This is the portal.broad institute. You please go to this website. If you go to this website, you will see a window that will look like this way. Because you copied sequence from the ensemble, paste control V sequence here. After you pasted the sequence here, this is the sequence of first exon of dirt gene. Please select the mouse because we are going to knock out the gene in the mouse. This is the dirt gene of the mouse. Please select this way, this one. And please select CRISPR knockout because we want to knock out experiment. Please select this one. SPYO Cas9, this is having the NGG PAM sequence. This is containing NGG PAM sequence. Please select the bulk and please select the OK somewhere here in the bottom. After you select OK, what will happen? They will be performing their job and they are retrieving the target sequence to design the CRISPR-Cas9. After the process is complete, this window will appear and this window, please click somewhere here, pick results. After you click the pick results, this notepad file will be opened. This is having the target sequence that are somewhat scattered here, is not visible very much. So please control A, perform select all and open new Excel file and make control V. When you will make control V paste in the Excel file, what will happen? This kind of arranged target sequence will appear. So we are interested somewhere here. This is the sgRNA sequence. You should know that sgRNA, the target sequence, can be selected either from the sense strand or from the antisense strand. For example, we have selected sense strand that is having a cut at 175 nucleotide away from the start of the first exon. And this target sequence, this target can be achieved by the use of this this complementary and target sequence in the CRISPR-Cas9. So please copy this sequence. After you copy this sequence, write reverse complement in the Google. And then select the first. Click the first one, reverse complement, this one. After you click this one, please paste the sequence here. And select here reverse complement and click submit. After you click submit, this reverse complement will appear. You need the initial target sequence and its reverse complement both. Please copy both sequence, and this is the target sequence that was obtained from the Broad Institute, and this is its reverse complement. For the target sequence that you took from the Broad Institute website, please add CACC. Upstream at the 5' end of the target sequence, and for the reverse complement on the 5' end, add AAAAC. After you do this thing, if you make the complement, if you reverse the sequence, invert the sequence, you can see the complementary site. Actually, this should be somewhere here, this way. I did not arrange it well. These are actually complementary. Okay, so you have to order these two oligos from the company just like you order the primers. After you order the sequence of these primers, you will anneal those primers. Okay, so this GCT, you can see GCT, this is the exon 1, and GCT, next one is GCG. You can see this red one is the target sequence that has been shown in this sequence, and this is the AGG. Mean NGG mean N mean any sequence, any nucleotide, and GG mean it is must. This is the PAM sequence. Upstream of PAM sequence, these 20 nucleotide have been selected to design the guided RNA. If we take the sequence, this sequence of upper strand, and we design the oligos, the Cas9 will bind to the bottom strand. The guided RNA will bind to the bottom strand. The guided RNA bind to the opposite strand of the PEM sequence. Okay, so we will be moving next. These plasmids have been ordered, and we have annealed those plasmids, those primers, because they have complementary sites. And after we did perform, we dissolved the CRISPR guided oligos to make 100 micromolar dilution. This is the method to anneal them. After we anneal, what will happen? We obtain this plasmid from the ADG. This plasmid has to be obtained from the ADG. This plasmid name is PX330. This whole protocol has been taken from my experimental manual, Experimental Biochemistry and Biotechnology Series 2. Actually, this has been taken from the Series 2. I published in 2019. Yes, it was published in 2019. This is from the Series 2. This experiment has been written in detail in the Series 2. So this whole reaction is set up along with the annealed oligos, and this reaction is repeated 37. What will happen? The restriction will happen, and at 23 the oligos will be introduced, will be annealed, will be ligated inside the this CRISPR plasmid. CRISPR plasmid is PX330. So what will happen? The final plasmid will be, this one is same for every knockout system. This one is same. Only the ordered oligos have been introduced somewhere here to make it a guided RNA for the first exon of the touch. So next, we are going to transform the ligated plasmid into the E. coli, and we are going to perform the mini prep extraction. After we perform the mini prep extraction, we will design two primers. One primer will be upstream of the target cutting site, and one primer will be downstream of the cutting site. And we will perform, by the use of these two primers, the qPCR, and we are going to get the MELD curve. For the wild type allele, the MELD curve will be very systematic and will smoothly go down. But for the knockout allele, the qPCR is going to go this kind of disturbed, irregular peak. This is the MELD curve, and this MELD curve must have a capability of falling after 84. If it is falling somewhere here, this MELD curve is not centric. It must fall after the 84 degrees centigrade during the temperature. So this is the sample that is having a knockout allele, and this is the wild type. In this way, we can distinguish which one is successfully knocked out and which one is not. So we are now next going to perform the knockout inside the mouse embryos. How can we do the knockout? Cas9 protein, mRNA, is synthesized. Cas9 mRNA is synthesized, and the sgRNA is synthesized in the in vitro. We can perform the in vitro transcription. And this is the experiment that is utilized to generate the knockout embryos, knockout mice, by the use of Cas9 protein and sgRNA. This is the whole protocol. You can read after this one. This will also be uploaded on the YouTube channel or somewhere, right? Even after this live webinar, you can see this video present online. So Cas9 protein and the sgRNA have been prepared and are kept at this concentration for the microinjection inside the embryos. And this one is the protocol you can see later. And this is the protocol that is utilized to make the Cas9 mRNA and definitely sgRNA for injection. In the previous slide, it was Cas9 protein, and here it was Cas9 mRNA. Just like the corona vaccines are, some are RNA based and some are whole virus. And in the same way, this strategy in the several years back was adopted, that whether the Cas9 mRNA after injection is more efficient or Cas9 protein after the injection is more efficient. So next we moved forward. There are two strategies anyone can be utilized. This is TALEN strategy, and this is the guided RNA, the CRISPR-Cas9 strategy. We have designed the CRISPR-Cas9 in the previous slide, and we have prepared the Cas9 protein, Cas9 mRNA, and the guided RNA. When we injected this CRISPR-Cas9 inside the cell line, it made a double strand break. At the site, we have the yellow color to distinguish which base pairs are deleted. So there are two possibilities. One is the non-homologous end joining. After the double strand break, cell try to repair its genome, and in hurry it makes a mistake, and five base pairs have been deleted. Only one yellow you can see here. This is the deletion that happens after the double strand break by the CRISPR or any of the technology. And one possibility is there. You can see six yellow are there and some extra bases are there. This is the insertion. Any of the DNA fragment we found near the double strand break, cell machinery quickly take up that and make it as an insertion. And that insertion even is going to make the double strand break. For example, five base pairs have been gone. It means frame shift is there. If six were gone, frame shift was not there. Five base pair frame shift is there, and the protein made will be mutant protein. And here we can see the four base pairs are added. It is again the frame shift. It's again going to make the mutant protein, the non-functional protein. And sometimes third possibility is there after the double strand break in the non-homologous end joining, that some insertion and some deletions are occurring together. You can see the three yellow have gone, and red and brown and black have been introduced at the site of double strand break. And there is another possibility after the double strand break, that we artificially allow the cell to perform the homology directed recombination. We provide a knockout insert or any of the transgene that is having the complementary left hand arm and right hand arm complementary around the site of double strand break. So cells, because of their double strand break, take this new cassette. It may be the knockout cassette, it may be the transgenic cassette, takes this with high efficiency. Like in 10 minutes, 5 times, it may be possible that it is going to take the firm cassette, and it's all happening the high efficiency is because of the double strand break. So this kind of mechanism is going on during the deletion of a gene inside the mouse. So what is happening? So this whole things have gone, we are not going to use embryonic stem cells. We are not going to produce by ourselves, and we are not going to produce, we are not even going to take from the International Mouse Knockout Mouse Consortium, but we are using the CRISPR-Cas9. And the embryos, the fertilized eggs are then injected with either the Cas9 protein and the guided RNA directly, because these are going to delete and mutate the gene of our interest. And these have been embryos, these have been performed with the embryo transfer inside the pseudo pregnant female that is now that has been artificially made the pregnant. And this step has are gone. We don't need to waste time here. And in 19 days, we can get, you can say, or 20 days, we can get the knockout mice. And that journey of 1.5 year has been reduced to 2 to 3 months. Our lab has successfully made almost 40 strains, and we were part of the knockout mouse generation by the use of this technology. So 2 to 3 months only it takes to generate the knockout mice. So this is the era of engineered nucleases that has taken all these time-consuming steps. So these are the real example that I have collected for you. This is the FOXN1 gene, and this is the exon shown in yellow, and this is the DNA PKC gene, this is the exon 2, and this is the PAM sequence NGG that has been shown with GGG. And we have taken the green one as the target sequence, and this target sequence is joined with this guided RNA scaffold part joined and then expressed along with the Cas9 gene to cut somewhere from here. So I once again stress that the Cas9 protein usually cuts 3 base pair away from the PAM sequence. Cas9
Am I audible to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, you are.
जी प्लीज मैम, अगर किसी को कोई क्वेश्चन है तो वो डिस्कशन सेशन के अंदर डॉक्टर मोहम्मद अली से पूछ सकता है. और हमारे पास ऑलरेडी एक क्वेश्चन जो है वो चैट बॉक्स में आ चुका है. एंड क्वेश्चन इज, आर द म्यूटेशन इंड्यूस्ड बाय एनएचएजी आर बेनिफिशियल इन एनी केस? जी डॉक्टर मोहम्मद अली.
Ikra, I think so. Dr. Ali is facing some internet issue.
Yes, let's wait for him. Ji, Dr. Muhammad Ali, you have muted yourself.
Yes, I some short key actually muted myself. Can you hear me now? Okay, okay. Mm-hmm. So some of the slides are still remaining. Can I continue? Can I complete?
Yes, sure. Yes, sure, sir. Okay. You can continue.
Okay. Okay. Can you see?
Yes.
Okay. Share. Something very share. Okay, I can see.
जी, तब तक अगर किसी के और भी क्वेश्चन है तो काइंडली वो चैट बॉक्स में जो है वो अपने क्वेश्चन पेस्ट कर दें एंड वेट फॉर क्यूए सेशन प्लीज.
ओके सो आई एम बैक हियर सो आई विल बी केयरफुल नाउ. Okay, so we have.
Thank you so much, Dr. Muhammad Ali. Please.
So just like some minus 80 degree vaccines of corona are available, and some people are interested to inject directly the antigen, the mRNA of the antigen of the coronavirus. Similarly, in several years back, we tried the introduction of the Cas9 mRNA and the guide RNA, definitely that is RNA, directly into the cytoplasm. And we also tried the injection of the Cas9 protein with guide RNA in the cytoplasm and in the nucleus, in the male pronuclei. Okay, so what happened? We were interested to compare the result, whether the mRNA injection or whether the complex of Cas9 protein along with the guide RNA in the cytoplasm or the pronuclei, which one is better. So we generated the knockout mice and we tested those mice with the T7E1 assay. This is, for example, the wild type allele. This is definitely knockout allele or shorter in length when they are joined together. When they are melted and kneeled together, this kind of loop is formed. And this kind of loop is deleted because of the T7 endonuclease. And for all the wild type, we see only the one fragment. And for all the knockout, we see the several fragments. This is the NGG sequence. You can see triple G. This is N and this is GG sequence, and we can see several deletions have appeared in different founder mice. This is number one founder, number three, number two. Let me show you how to read these kind of knockout results. This is delta 11. Delta 11 means 11 base pair have been deleted. So we can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11s have been deleted. Sometimes there is an introduction of a new base. This is 1+1. This green has been shown. This is showing the introduction of one base pair extra. And this is DEL 25. 25 base pair have been deleted. And we design now primer upstream of this target, this knockout site, and downstream of this knockout site. And what was the success rate? If we introduce the RNA in the cytoplasm, RNA of the Cas9 protein that will express definitely to make the Cas9 protein, and the guided RNA, and we obtained the 91% success. This is the real result from our lab. And these are the different concentration of the guided RNA, different concentration of definitely Cas9 mRNA is at the same, but the guided RNA has been introduced at different concentration. 91% success has been obtained for the knockout of the mice. If we introduce the complex Cas9 protein and the guided RNA into the pronuclei, 88% was successful. And in the cytoplasm, 71%. It means in the nucleus, injection of microinjection of the complex in the nucleus is successful. And the RNA of that protein was introduced in the cytoplasm even has the highest success of 91%. Okay. We move next. This is the real data from our lab. FOXN1 was knocked out in the mice and PRKDC1 was knocked out in the mice, and we obtained 67% and 43% respectively for each gene. For each gene, the efficiency of the knockout may be different. And this is again in the efficiency of FOXN1 gene, and this is again the efficiency of DNA PKC's gene, that is 43% and 67% for each gene. And these are the results, knockout results for the DNA PKC's gene. And we can see some deletions are there, some insertions are there. And we can see this kind of complex data. This is very useful. So this is my last slide, that different applications of CRISPR-Cas9s are there. We can use the dCas9 SAM for the activation of a gene expression. We can use the repressed gene expression by the use of dCas9. We can do histone acetylation. We can perform the demethylation of the histone. We can do the demethylation of the DNA, and we can perform the, we can methylate the CpG site on the DNA. And this is my institute, the Hubert Faisalabad Institute of Research Science and Technology. This is lush green. This is 27 acres of the area in our campus. And this is one of the internship that will be run throughout the year. I introduced through this platform of the UMT Sialkot. I am very much thankful to UMT Sialkot for inviting me. And these are the different research facilities at our institute at Hubert Faisal Wadh Institute of Cell Science and Technology. We have the Mammalian Molecular Genetics Lab. We have Animal Cell Culture Lab. We have the Laboratory Animal Research Center. We have Biotechnology Lab. We have High-Tech Lab. We have Microbiology Lab, Tissue Culture Lab. We have Plant and Biofuel Lab. And these are some of the links of my website, my YouTube channel that is providing the resources for the students. So thank you very much for listening to me. So that's all. So now I go for the questions. So the first question was, so whether the non-homologous end joining is beneficial or not? May I go for the answer?
Yes, sir. Yes, please. Thank you so much for your... time to answer the question of student. So the first question was, are the mutation induced by NHGJ are beneficial in any case?
Actually,
would you please answer this?
Yes. NHEJ, non-homologous end joining, is utilized usually for the knockout to remove the function of that gene. It cannot be useful. It cannot be useful. It will make the mutant protein that will be recognized as a foreign particle just in case of immunity and will be deleted by cells, its own machinery. So, and sometime some gain of undesired function may also be problem. For example, some consistent activation of a protein may cause some problem. So it is usually not beneficial NHEJ based deletion. Yes, next please.
So we have next question. Can we treat genetic disorder with the technique like hemophilia? It's the question.
Yes.
From Vakas Faroo.
Definitely. So it has so much high efficiency. Even we can delete or add a region of up to 9, 8, 10 kb. It is reported already. Several years back it has been reported. And even point mutation, definitely if the point mutation is there, like hemophilia is there, 1-2 base pairs are different from what native protein required. By the use of this homologous arm, by the use of this wild type sequence, we can definitely treat those kind of diseases. But the problem usually in the gene therapy is that how to deliver those genes at the required place. This is sometimes problem, but definitely it can repair any sequence.
Sir, we have second question again from Vakas Farooq. His question is, can we use guider RNAs to knock out genes involved in antimicrobial resistance?
Yes, we can knock out any gene. For example, in some diseases, some pathogen introduce its genome into the human, and that causes pathogenicity that causes. And if we delete those foreign DNA from the host genome, we can remove the pathogenicity, we can remove the effect of the pathogen, and definitely we can even mutate the microorganisms and their microbial resistance will go. Definitely we can do the genetic engineering in the prokaryotes. We can do.
Sir, we have again a question. Can we inhibit replication of COVID-19 in its affected patient by using this technology?
Actually, I'm not very much expert in the microbiology, so I'm not sure about this one. Until there is no report, so I cannot.
Sir, we have another question, please. If any case of target mutation occur, what we can do to avoid them?
Actually, CRISPR has almost 99% efficiency. It is precise. It is precise. And actually, only one solution is there for the off-targeting checking. We have to do the genome sequencing, whole genome sequencing. Then we can know that only our desired mutation is there. Whole genome sequencing is the only solution to check perfectly whether there is any off-targeting or not.
Sir, we have another question. Please bear with us. Why we are not using technology to inhibit the COVID? Okay, why we are not using this technology to inhibit the COVID? Yes, that's the question from Ruba Shahid.
Bacteria use this technology. This technique has been taken from the bacteria. They were using these against viruses. So I think technology, we need more work to establish the proliferation of the viruses, COVID-19 viruses, by use of technology. We need more work until we have not understood. And we know that the sequence of the COVID-19 virus is changing and again and again, and we are not fully capable to stop their mutation. Because the viruses, they are working 24 hours and we are working only 12 hours. They are mutating and they are changing their resistance. So we have to work more and more to find those specific targets that are stable and that are, you can say, the conserved regions, and then we can target those. We have to do more work. Until now, we cannot say.
Okay, we have a question from Rabia Vaseem. What are the drawbacks of this technique, especially in the case of mice? Can the mutated knocked out mice live normally even after this genome editing normal life cycle?
It depends. Yes. Okay. Yeah, it depends on the type of gene. If the gene is very, very important, like if you gap DH, if you knocked out gap DH, the mice will not survive. Like you remove some gene that is inducing the autophagy in mice that are important in fasting, that are important, very important right after the birth, then the mice will not survive. That's why we are moving towards the conditional knockout, that mice are born and they are adult. Now we want to perform experiment for those genes, and now we can do the knockout of those genes. It depends upon the gene, which gene you have knocked out. If you have knocked out some very important gene, the mice will not survive. Even there will be no, you can say, the birth. Even there is sometimes no birth, no even the fertilization. If the, you knock out very important gene, there's no birth, even no newborn. Some genes are even toxic. If you overexpress those genes, the newborns are not there. I was making some transgenic mice and I could not find any newborn because those genes were toxic. In natural expression, they were not toxic. So it depends upon the gene.
Okay.
In many times, third knockout gene, sir, for example, I knock, yes.
Sir, we have another question. Can you, respected sir, can you please explain that how we treat diseases like cystic fibrosis by using mouse model? Is the question.
For the treatment of any disease, first of all, we have to generate the same model in the mouse. First of all, we will test those models for the treatment, then we will move to the human. So, this is sometime the genes that are required, that are utilized in the induction of fibrosis or some other thing. If those genes can be downregulated, then we can control this way. But we have to study those specific trait, those specific genes, those specific expression, those all array of expression, then we can decide. Simply we cannot say. We cannot control one by the deletion or by the insertion of one gene that this disease will be controlled. Many traits are in a way that they are they are depending upon the expression of many genes, like QTLs, quantitative trait loci. They are depending upon the expression of many genes. Until we control all of those, we cannot say this can be controlled. And we have to study the physiology, the phenotype, and the pathology of those diseases, then we can do. And it can do any kind of deletion, the CRISPR-Cas9, it can do any kind of insertion. It can do insertion of up till 8-9 kb. It can do deletion of 4-3-4-5 kb. It can do this kind of work. Yes, please.
Okay, sir, we have another question. That is 40 strains that were successfully mutated in Ahuwat using Argen. Did they turn out to be some kind of breakthrough in gene therapy? Or is this research just limited to first with zero applicability to human diseases in real world? That is a question from Habiba Majid. And soon we would end the session. I think you would
Okay, this was done actually in my lab during my PhD, not in a food first. In Pakistan, until we don't have the technology for the mouse genetically modified mouse models, we don't have technology in Pakistan, and these expertise are not there. I learned these all expertise from during my PhD in South Korea. These 40 mouse models were generated to understand the function of those genes. And until we utilize the knowledge for the function of those genes, this 40 knockout mouse is not going to add anything. We have to understand their role in the disease. If we understand those roles, then we have to control the regulation, the expression of those genes, then it is beneficial. Making knockout cell line, making some plasmid, it's just like making reagents. After we gain information from those mice, from those lines, how is their process, then we can get some breakthrough. And most importantly, one more thing let you know, all my participants, many times in our body, one gene is not always knocked out, not always silent, not always overexpressing. It is regulated. Sometimes it is expressing less, sometimes it is expressing more. Just like in pancreas, the insulin mRNA is expressed more when we eat sweet thing, and it is less expressive when we don't. And it's all sensed by our body organs and the receptors, cell receptors. So we have to go for the regulation of the gene if we want to treat the disease. It is not merely the knocking out or knocking in is the treatment of disease. We have to understand the mechanism under those regulations. Yes, please.